Right? Merry Easter. And Rosemary's Keister. Jeez Louise, there's a girl over there wearing a dress
with some kind of trousers underneath.
We'll be right back. nothing wrong with you. Living in a summer spell. Double up and run like hell.
Different phase that we're in is just a time capsule of us at that time in our lives, and especially with a band like us, because it's such a non-contrived thing. It's just what we're feeling at that moment, and that's it. So I think that our music being relevant has to do with us being honest to where we're at and just not being contrived.
Now, hopefully, as a musician and as a guy who's a fourth of a band, I can, along with my fellow musicians, keep evolving and trying new stuff. And people mentioned that they liked the singing better on this record than the last record. That's fine. I liked all of the different weird stages I've gone through as a vocalist to get where I am today. I appreciate, all levels of ability and phrasing and, whatever it takes to do my job in this band as a singer and a 1/4 songwriter. They grow. I try to keep up. They play music. It inspires me to sing in a certain way. A lot of it's just me bouncing energy off this great wall of sound that develops at rehearsal. Every time I go in there, something, beautiful is flying around the room, and I just try to, dive in that stream and, make some noise that sounds right.
When I was a young man, one time, I went to go see a band called the Circle Jerks play at this little warehouse, yep. And they started playing. And it was so violent when they started playing, not that people were hurting each other or anything, but the way they attacked their instruments, that I was afraid. And it was a beautiful feeling. That's a great fear.
Outside, but not to brawl, and autumn sweet, we call the fall out.
Scottish did a wish you saw. Sarcastic meant to know it all. Close your eyes and I'll kiss you, cause with the birds I'll share. With the birds I'll share.
Danny California happens to be based on a character who appears and, by the way, is kind of the connection. You know, it's more like she jumped from one song into another song. But energetically, they're just so different. And it wasn't something that I really set out to do. It just kind of, it accidentally happened. And somewhere along the way, I realized that's the same girl, jumped from one song to another.
Lee, you'll have to forgive me. I threw up a little bit in the second chorus.
Yeah.
A little bit. Oh, no, in the bridge. I'm sorry. A little vomit came up during the bridge there.
Did you rinse your throat?
Too soon before you play.
Did you rinse your throat? It's really bad for your teeth. If you ever throw up, be sure and gargle with water afterwards, because the acid in the vomit will damage your teeth. Hooray!
You know, there's always a healthy competitiveness between us, because we're all, you know, wanting to give and wanting to, you know, to show the other guys, look, I did something great, you know, do you like it? And we want everyone to like it. And so it's always, we're always, you know, when you're with the four guys and everyone's putting out their thing, you can't, just human nature to have an air of competitiveness. But really, more than anything, it's just giving, wanting to give something good that the other three guys like, and wanting to support the visions that the other ones put forward.
If there's any competition, from my perspective, it's almost like you're just playing a little game for a second. Like, it's not serious competition. It's more about four people becoming one. You know, it's more about four people uniting to create one thing together and to work as one force together. You know, like in Chad and Mai's case, like we'll look at like Pete Townsend and Keith Moon, like where there actually is a competitive thing going on, and we're inspired by that energy. So we might bring that energy to rehearsal while we're jamming or something, but we don't actually have it in our hearts to be like
John,
angry at each other the way those guys were, you know? One shot, pull out me, rock out with the wind and bleed. Till death, do it hot, break my heart so I can stop. Super kind of fantasy to get me in the future. It's twisted, but I must insist. Time to get on top of this. Having the opportunity to live a creative existence, I just feel really lucky being a person who's born, you know, with this as being what was in store for me, is to pretty much just make my life a constant creativity. And when it's not creative, it's doing the things that a person does to make themselves the best they can be to be creative. You know, I've been pretty good with taking care of myself in the last 7 years. You know, since I rejoined the band. And I just feel really lucky. I also, it has partly to do with the fact that I had that outside perspective of totally disappearing from the human race, sort of, in a lot of ways. I didn't have fame to cling to anymore. I didn't have like money to cling to anymore. I didn't have like friends who supported me to cling to. And I see these things differently now than I saw them then. I see them all as a chance for freedom, you know, from me as an individual, you know, that I didn't appreciate or take full advantage of the first time around. So, you know, for me, like at a time like a couple of years ago when I had 6 months off, it was just like, I'm just gonna record as much music as I can, you know? Also because when we're on tour, I write a lot of music, but I don't have a chance to record it all, you know?
So that was you know, right now I'm looking for a little window where I can make another album that I have the music planned for, and I just I've been working so hard promoting the Chili Peppers that there's been no time lately, but I'm gonna squeeze it in there, you know.
You know your eyes in the morning sun. I feel you touch me in the pouring rain. And the moment that you wander far from me, I wanna feel you in my arms again. And you come to me on a summer breeze. Give me warm in your arms, then you softly leave. And it's me you need to show. How deep is your love? Your love, how deep is your love? I really mean to learn. Cause we're living in a world of fools, breaking us down when they all should let us be. We belong to you.
How you guys doing? Good?
Good.
Feeling a lot of love coming from this little area right there.
To me, I remember, you know, when I was a kid, that when I was in junior high and I first really sort of became kind of conscious about popular culture and music. And to me, and I'm not sure if they were the biggest or not, but to me, the biggest band in the world was Earth, Wind & Fire. And I always, like to this day, I always really admire them, as I remember that everybody liked them, you know. Like at school, it was always like, you know, there were the kids that liked Kiss, you know, the kids that liked P-Funk, and that was real separate. But like, P-Funk. But everybody liked Earth, Wind & Fire.
Kiss. P-Funk.
Yeah. But everybody liked Earth, Wind & Fire, and not just black and white people, young people, old people.
Chinese?
The Mexican community in Los Angeles. Chinese hated them.
No, Chinese loved Earth, Wind & Fire.
It was the Koreans.
The Chinese guy turned me on Earth, Wind & Fire.
I must have been a Taiwanese, I'm thinking of. But anyways, to me, that was always something to reach for. And you know, when I was a kid, I was a trumpet player. I liked they had horns and a jazz influence and stuff. But I still think of them all the time. And it's like, music is this big picture, you know, and our music is really for everybody, you know, and we're influenced by everything, and we love everything, all kinds of music. There's every category of music has something beautiful in it that we love and that affects us profoundly, and that's, you know.
There were such black acts like Olivia Newton-John that really spoke to us growing up, and no, I'm kidding, of course, but I do want to give a shout out to our record label as not bothering us at all when it comes to like with the music that we make. They do not hassle us. They do not, you know, suggest things to us. They're not like, oh, well, that's great, but that's not. They really give us complete freedom, and we're pretty lucky to be in that position too.
This place was made on you and
one thing that seems to have changed is that as we've changed and remained teachable and enthusiastic and kind of, you know, into inventing and experimenting with new stuff and new experiences, I think so too has Rick Rubin, you know, as a producer. He hasn't just like relied on what he did that was successful 10 years ago or whatever. He's like a kid, you know, music still makes him happier than anything else in the world. And I think he's been willing to, you know, evolve and to remain enthusiastic about music in the same way that we have. So it's not like we kept growing, he stayed the same. He kind of, you know, matched our excitement. And that's kind of cool for a guy who's been doing it as long as he has to still treat it like it means everything in the world.
I think our, you know, our personal relationships with him always have, you know, shifted and changed throughout the years. But our working relationship with him, I think, I don't know if you guys all agree with me, I think it's pretty much the same. You know, I mean, we do our thing. We write the music, we write the songs, we put it all together. Then we get together with him and he gives us a really, you know, we trust his objective opinion on what we're doing. And it's very helpful to have that you know, calm, objective opinion, because we're not always calm and objective people. And, you know, it's not like there's one leader in our band or anything. And we're all kind of, you know, putting out ideas and stuff. And it's helpful to have that objective opinion that we trust.
For showing up to the show. You guys are a great audience, thank you.
I don't think any of us really go into the creative elements of writing music and songs and hanging out as a band, thinking about what kind of numbers of records we've sold. I mean, we're grateful and we're pleased and we love reaching lots of people and it's exciting to sell records. But when we go and we get into a small rehearsal studio and we start jamming and writing, it's really, honestly, it's the last thing on anybody's mind. It's a blessing. We're sort of free of that kind of interference when we're writing.
There is a certain energy that's inside the when you're in a band who's been going for this long and there's a certain amount of love coming from people, like, I don't discount that figures largely into the music we make, but we're not conscious of it. But I feel that it is a transference that happens where the love that people send out works its way into the music, you know? I feel pretty sure of that, you know? But it's not, has nothing to do with how many are going to buy the records, because that's a future thing.
Get back.